the Aloha Hour with Johny and Dewey.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for tuning in today. As always, we have a very special guest. He's a big wave world tour champion, a four-time winner of the Peahi Challenge. He's a father. He is a mentor. He is a ambassador of Aloha. He is Billy Kemper, everybody. That's what's up. Now, Billy, thank you very much for coming.
Thank you, guys.
It means the world to us. But before we're going to start talking about you, and we want to talk about you, we want to talk about your start, we want to know everything about you. But before we're going to start, Dewey and I watched your little video clip of you and Lion doing the barrel at the Surf Ranch. That video went viral. Everybody everywhere in the world reposted this video. I had goosebumps, and Dewey had goosebumps, and we are both fathers.
I cried.
Yeah. 100%. Like, I teared up. I watched it maybe 60 times. And Dewey and I really wanted to somehow bring our appreciation to you and Lion. So we made you guys a trophy.
No way. The world champ trophy.
This is the trophy.
That is so sick. And wow, there we go. Lion Kemper, first barrel of the century.
Hey, forget so all sick. The world champion thing. This wow. is going to be the best thing.
That is so sick. Thank you guys so much.
Hey, the world, wait. Billy is blushing. His face is red.
No, thank you guys, man. That that day was really special for me. I mean, as we'll go into it, I recently went through a pretty serious injury, and WSL kind of gifted me my first day back surfing up at the Surf Ranch, and you know, I was like, well, who do I bring? Obviously, I'm going to bring my family, my brother, my nephew, and some of my closest friends who have been a part of my journey. And it was weird. My five-year-old son, Hayes, didn't want to surf that day. I don't know if he was intimidated.
Usually he
by
surfs,
the pool.
Though.
For sure. He holds onto my back at Aukai, like on my like a cape, and charges. Like, any wave we're going on, he's just psyched. And he was over it. And Lion that day, he just turned 3 years old. He's like, Dad, I want to get barreled. I was like, well, today's your day. And, yeah, I took him out. It was. It's funny, you know, that wave, and I think not only that wave in general, but just riding a wave with, you know, your own legacy, your own child, for me, is my pride and joy. It's more rewarding than any wave I've ever rode in my life. And it's like, people are like, oh, it's so cool, it's fun, but like, my heart rate and the sensation that I got leaving that day of just sharing a wave, and also, I mean, sharing a barrel with a three-year-old kid that is my
insane.
My son, my yeah. you know, the kid who fought to live. He was born with some defects and broke through them all. Like, it really opened up a different chapter of life, and that wave was really special for me.
Sorry, I gotta get into it. As a father, and I have two sons and a daughter. I'm 56, and my son now 36, 30. My daughter's 26. And when I did that, when I saw you in bed, because that's what I do my shit at night, I was just like, wow, that's like every surfer who has a son or a daughter, doesn't matter, right? Dream
100%.
Of doing that, because the best thing you can do for my son at track was put him in the boogie board and put him deep.
Yeah.
And let him eat shit. And for that one moment, he gets up and he felt that little thing
yeah.
called a barrel. He's hooked, right?
Yeah.
And when you did that, it was like one of the most vulnerable. I know it sounds stupid, but it was one of the most vulnerable, beautiful moments between a father and a son.
You could actually feel the
yeah,
energy
yeah,
just
it
watching
was like
you guys.
That thing's going to be like, I don't know.
Yeah. It was,
it's already,
knows?
It went viral everywhere.
Oh, yeah,
everybody
yeah, yeah.
reposted it. It was insane. I mean, what a crazy way to come up, like, remember that amazing day, yeah?
For sure. And that was honestly just a glimpse. I'll go into it later, but I'm working on a documentary series on basically my upbringing going into the run that I was on last winter, and my trip to Morocco where I went through this injury and a road to recovery to, you know, returning to surf Jaws this winter. So that will be airing in January 2021. Six chapters, six-piece series, and that whole day will be highlighted on there. So
I can't wait for that to come out.
Yeah. We can't wait to watch it. Let's start with Billy Kemper, little boy. You grew up on born in Maui.
Yeah.
And then you moved to Oahu.
Yeah.
For surf?
Yeah, I mean, I was born in a little town in Kuau and Haiku. It's real close. One's on the ocean, one's 5 minutes from the ocean. And I was born in a household with two older brothers, Carl, Eric, my mom and dad. And my brother Eric at this point, you know, when I was born, he was 10 years older than me. At that age, at 11 years old, he basically broke all the amateur records with the NSSA Nationals. He won two titles in 1 year. Kalani Rob the following year went on to do the same. But he was at the forefront of amateur surfing. I mean, his competitors were Andy and Bruce and Kaimana Henry and Nainoa Surad. And my brother was a step ahead of all of them. And, you know, there's stuff on the news here that I still have on VHS of, you know, literally the news station saying, like, you know, this is before Derek Ho won his world title. Like, Hawaii might have a chance at winning a world title with Eric Diaz. And he was a star, you know. And when I was born, I had a brother as a star. You know, he was everything. And we had a really good connection. And so did me and my brother Carl. But the bond that me and Eric had growing up was unbelievable. You know, it was everything I could ever dream of having as an older brother, a mentor, a leader. And
he's the middle child? Eric was the oldest child.
Yes, he was.
He was the middle child. Okay, yeah, so Carl was the oldest.
Yeah, exactly. There, Eric was 10 years older. My brother Carl's 12 years older than me. So I was much younger than both of them. And my parents separated at a young age. It was a complete nightmare. My parents didn't talk outside of a courtroom from my age of 5 years old until my day of graduation. So they had restraining orders. It was a nightmare. It definitely took a toll on me as a child just growing up. But, you know, my brother was living here on the North Shore with the Surratts and the Rothmans competing, and Calvin Maieto over at Locomotion. He was traveling internationally starting at the age of 8 years old competing. Like, it would be really, really young.
Yeah.
And when he was 18 years old, I was 8 years old, still living on Maui with my mom, he fell up at Kahuku Motocross Track on a dirt bike and shattered his heel. And that led to doctors, x-rays, MRIs, to, okay, here's some painkillers, and, you know, you got to get surgery, and this is how you'll get past day to day from now. And my brother was scared shitless of getting surgery, and those painkillers led from, you know, daily routine into, you know, what's next after this, what's going to take the pain. You're basically looking at painkillers as synthetic heroin is how I look at it. And that injury drew him away from his true friends and the people who loved him for what he did. And he started hanging out with, you know, shady people, wrong place. And that led him into, you know, getting down in this road of doing drugs. And when that started to, you know, snowball, my mom, I remember her looking at me like, hey, we have to move to Oahu. You know,
did you understand the situation back then?
Yeah, I did. I mean, I did as I grew. I understood it a lot more, but I, you know, there was moments of my childhood where, you know, my brother was strung out on drugs and he would tell me, oh, we're going to go camping. And I didn't know this. I'm 7, 8 years old. And he's like, oh, okay. And I would go night fishing with him and camp on the rocks in a tent for 6, 7 days. And then 5 police officers show up, arrest my brother and take me in a cop car. And I'm just like, what's going on? And, you know, they've filed police reports that I've been kidnapped and this and that. And
also, they didn't know you went with him voluntarily.
Heading. My mom and dad were freaking out because my brother was high on dope He was just like, he truly, like, you know, I was everything to him. And I think I was never endangered with him. There's no one in the entire world who made me feel as safe and comfortable as my brother Eric. And throughout all this, my mom basically was like, hey, we're moving to Oahu. We're going to get your brother surgery. We're going to get him off drugs. And we're going to get him back in New Jersey competing. And he's like, to the world tour he goes. I was like, okay. You know, obviously she wasn't telling me the drugs and all that kind of stuff, but we're moving to Oahu. I moved here, and my brother, as we flew here, he flew back to Maui to get his stuff that he had there, the rest of his stuff. And on Maui, he ended up with the wrong people on the wrong night, and he overdosed on drugs. And that day, it was in 1998, just it kind of, you know, it started a new life for me. I lost the most important life, and it started a new life of, like, you know, there's little things my brother told me when I was a kid, like, hey, one day I'm going to be the first guy from Maui to be in the Eddie Aikau. I'm going to be the first guy to win the Eddie Aikau from Maui. Like, I'm going to represent us. Like, I want to be in the Eddie. And things like that have just been, like, embedded in my brain. And, you know, fast forward 20 years later, and it's like, when I got that invitation, I was just like, oh, like, you know, I didn't do it for myself. I did it for the person who brought me here, the person who aimed me in this direction. And I kind of tell people and look at it as like, you know, my brother paved the way for me. I'd followed his footsteps until I came to that intersection of, like, you know, there's trouble this way, but there's success this way. And it, you know, it's difficult. Don't get me wrong. You know, I've gotten into my trouble. I've hung out with the wrong people. I've partied my ass off in Las Vegas and LA, around the world. I've seen every kind of party and good time a man could possibly see. And it was, you know, honestly, it was my family that drove me to success. And, you know, here I am, 30 years old, very happy with where I'm at. Very, very happy and grateful.
And you should be.
I'm tripping out right now because I get a couple of things, right? I'm listening to you right now. And like, for some darn reason, you know, surfer from Outer Islands, Maui Kauai, he's got a, there's so many brilliant talent.
Yeah.
But the chance for them to come to Oahu compete, they need like almost a miracle. Somebody's got to deny them in, and you got, you know,
for sure.
You're so lucky, right?
Well, I was adopted by Brian Surratt and Eddie Rothman. And like,
because of your brother?
Like they had a love for my family that was, you know, unrelatable. From paying our rent to, like, you know, giving my mom cars to flying me across the world before I had sponsors, what Eddie Rothman and Brian Surratt did for my family was unbelievable. In a lifetime, I'll never be able to pay them back. And wow.
I think you are.
It's,
like, you know, I think that's extremely proud. No, I think they're extremely proud of the man you become and the father you become.
That's that. You know, I was doing an interview yesterday, and I told people, like, you know, when I go back to competing, it's like the day I put that jersey on, it's like, it is. There's so much nerves going through me from what I went through in the last 8 months, and you know, it's, I'm not gonna go back and compete for myself and my own sensations and adrenaline. I'm going to go out there and I'm going to put my last name, and my last name represents my family, my friends, my fans, my tribe, and also the people who've doubted me. You're a part of this because you've helped me grow. You've helped me succeed. And you know, that day where I go back,
all your hate. Thanks for the hate.
Exactly. But you know, I'm really looking forward to going back into competing and just getting back out there and surfing with, you know, the people who I love, Mother Nature, and some big waves.
I mean, it's like, it's I'm like so stoked, and I'm like, oh, like, wow, Billy. It's like Maui, right? You think Eric Diaz, gone.
Yeah.
Steve Cooney.
Yeah.
Holy crap. So it was like three legends.
Yeah,
that fell into the same trap. I don't get it. Like, these guys could.
That era was really radical.
Yeah.
I mean, I was born in 1990, and the same year I was born, my brother's biggest idol, Justin Roberson, the originator of aerial surfing.
Right.
Christian Fletcher was his right-hand man. They were partners in crime. And without Justin, you wouldn't have had Christian. Without Christian, you wouldn't have had Justin. And my middle name is Justin because my brother's biggest, his older brother and mentor was Justin Roberson. And, you know, I lost my brother when I was 8 years old. When I was 10 years old, I lost my stepsister. When I was 12 years old, I lost Steve Cooney, who was my brother's best friend. And then, like, I had, you know, so many people that I was so close to. Late, fast forward down the time, you know, a handful of my best friends. And leading into, you know, my mom's fight against cancer, it's like I've dealt with a lot of not even close friends, but, you know, the closest people that possible.
Let me ask you, how does it feel? I mean, you had so much adversity, you had so much challenges, you had so many things to go through, and it feels like you're getting jabbed and jabbed and jabbed and jabbed, but you're like, I don't care, I have a mission. You're like a train. You don't look right, you don't look left, you just look straight.
Yeah, for me, what I tell people is basically I was given a map at a young age, and there's a maze, and I've been walking through this maze, and I hit dead ends, and they hurt, but then I gotta reroute and find myself. And, you know, right now, where I'm at in life, I think I have the map completely dissected and understood of where I'm at and where I belong, and that map is navigating me through this injury. It's navigating me back to the ocean. It's navigating me to being the most present, best father I can be. And at the end of the day, it's like, all those awards and achievements and waves and, you know, all these big trophies, they mean so much. But at the end of the day, it's honestly all about your family. And that's what I try to get to at the end of every conversation. You know, it's like to create your own legacy and be able to give back of all the shitty stuff we've went through.
So your motivation, your strength, your power from your family.
For sure. You know, it's like, I lost those people I lost my mom the year I won the world title. And it was like,
but it was a month after, so at least she knew.
And it was weird, like I felt her holding on for it. And it was like I brought the trophy home to her the day she went into the hospital. The day I landed here after getting that trophy in Australia at the banquet was the day that she was like put into like ICU. And it was, you know, you look at things like that, and it's like, it's hard to say it's meant to be that you lose your family, your mom, your brother. Like, how is that meant to be? You took away the person who created me at, you know, she wasn't even in her 70s, and it hurts. But it's also, it's made me who I am, and it's also, I feel like, you know, I'm so grateful. I have a house, I have children, I have people who support me, I have love. And I think this is, I've been put on this earth to help people get through things.
I have to admit that when I look at you, I see everybody that is around you really loves you.
Yeah,
it's crazy. It's amazing, like, to see. They're all,
well, I think like that's where I feel like I've taken on a role internally. No one's ever told me to do this, but I feel like I've taken on a position in life where I want to make sure if you lose someone, you can call me. Or it's like if somebody loses somebody in the playoffs, you know, I don't know, by the grace of God, maybe they'll hear my story from somebody and get an understanding that, you know, losing people or going through a life-threatening injury or having drug addictions or alcohol addictions, all that stuff, at the end of every tunnel, at the end of every result, there is a bright light. Like, you can find it. You just, it's how hard are people willing to dig? And that's, I think, where I'm living proof that, honestly, it's like, I don't care how deep that hole is, you can dig to the bottom of it. It's just, you gotta have the mindset and the mentality of never giving up and just looking for brightness. That's kind of been my mentality of, like, no matter how dark life is, like, you can find light.
Definitely. And I know it took you a long time to get sponsored. You were fighting for it. You were working hard. You were training. You were, you know, we always watch a lot of highlights, a lot of videos about the people that we interview. One of the things that I was able to pick up that a lot of people spoke about is your work ethics, how hard you were willing to work, the sacrifice, the days in the gym, the switch that you did as far as your strength and conditioning. I mean, all that process, the boxing, I mean, all of that. Tell us a little bit about that.
For sure. You know, it's like I'm another example of living proof is, like, I had, you go back, like, amateur rankings, you go back, you know, before I was like, you know, my early days, there was no results. There was nothing there. And that was maybe just because of the way I took about my sport or what I was doing. You know, there's other, you know, things that were drawing my attention in separate ways, whether it was girls, whether it was, you know, I was really into spearfishing at a young age. I was, you know, hanging out, partying, enjoying life. And it kind of all fell into my best friend, Kai Barger, growing up in high school. We graduated high school, and Kahea Hart, who is my personal trainer now, was the team rep and also the trainer and coach for Hurley at the time, which Kai Barger was sponsored by. And Kahea has been like family to me, you know, before we started training. And he reached out to me. He's seen me probably pretty hungover, probably pretty beat up from a big night out. Underage, sneaking into the crazy box or doing something I shouldn't be doing. And he just said, hey, Kai's coming over to train for World Juniors for like 4 weeks. You want to come jump in? I was like, training? Like, oh, God. But I was like, yeah, let's do it. And, you know, the first week was so hard. Like, I couldn't even, like, walk downstairs. Like, sitting on a toilet in the morning, my glutes, hamstrings were just shot. And it just... it proved to me that I couldn't be good at everything. Like, I couldn't, like, I had to work to get better. Like, where surfing was so natural for me, everything I did in the ocean, I was fairly well at whatever it was, whether it was, you know, and this whole strength and conditioning and training was just a new envelope that I've never opened. And I was blown away by that first week, and went on, finished the basically like 3 or 4 weeks of training. And Kai went to Australia. I just went back to, you know, surfing and hanging on the North Shore. And Kai won a world title that week, and the first ever from Maui. That was huge. And it really just opened up a whole different category of life to me. I was like, whoa, you know, this is crazy. And, you know, that next year I was like, yeah, can you help me again? And he's like, yeah, let's do it. And you know, we started working together that year.
So when you say working together, what are you doing? Like, what is the
workout? At this stage, it was just the entry to physical training, to, okay, you know, circuit training. And what Kahea has done is he's created a formula of his own. He spent, you know, camps up at Big Bear with Oscar De La Hoya and Rob Garcia. He's a student of Rob Garcia. Rob is Oscar De La Hoya's old strength and conditioning trainer. Now Rob runs the athletic... boxing, basically, director of Mayweather. He works under Mayweather Senior. You want to talk about knowledge and fitness, this guy could write, you know, not a book, he could write a whole line of books of what he's went through, what he's learned, and what he's doing. And Kahea was a student to him alongside Sonny Garcia, Kalani Robb, Kelly Slater. There was a really tight group of guys that were, you know, training under Rob, and Kahea just fell in love with it. I think he's seen, you know, what strength and conditioning and taking care of your body can produce when you get onto a surfboard. And he brought that, started studying more things. He got his CrossFit coaching certification, then he got his Gymnastica Naturale. You know, it kind of snowball effect into all these yoga, everything. And he basically created, you know, from CrossFit to Gymnastica to yoga to now Foundation, XPT under Laird Hamilton. He's created all these certifications, all these coaching degrees into this Kahea Hart program. And I am his program. He's programmed me to be his athlete. And, you know,
you're the robot.
You're the product. I'm living proof. The first year I worked with him, I won the HIC Pro, the XL Pro, the year Andy passed away.
Right.
Literally that year, and I was just like, I'd never been on the podium of a QS event. I had no stickers on my board. All of a sudden, I win this thing.
Wait, who's making your board then, Matt?
Matt Kinoshita. Yeah. And like, you know, that was the beginning. And yeah, Kahea was like, oh, he worked hard. He got, wow, he tasted victory. And it just, we kept coming forward. I made a handful of finals. I got a couple more wins under my belt. And at the age of 25, I found out my girlfriend at the time was pregnant. And I was like, whoa, this is heavy. Like, right. I called my brother. I'm like, what do I do?
How old were you then?
Like, I'll be straight up honest. You know, the word, you know, like, literally like, do we keep it? Like, that's how scared I was. Yeah. And I was like, I talked to my brother, and my brother's like, hey, look at me. I was 24 years old when I found out, you know, his baby mama was pregnant with his son James. And my brother is the hardest working, most successful human on earth, my brother Carl. There's nobody who works as hard, nobody has hospitality like him. It's unbelievable. And he's like, my success came with my child. And I was like, well, that's all I need to hear. So I had a kid, and that was Hayes. And that year, they announced that they're having a paddle-in event, the first ever paddle-in surfing contest at Jaws. Jaws, for all the people who don't know it, where Jaws is located on the north shore of Maui. It brought me to big wave surfing. I got to tow and surf out there as a teenager, and it kind of put me on the map as far as recognition. I got a pretty crazy barrel at 17 years old out there and was up for a Ride of the Year award, and it really, I think, kind of just shined some light on me as far as the surf industry. And, you know, at this time, they were like, okay, you know, there's the big wave world tour all these guys are in, but we got to give four local wild cards. I was, I think, the fourth of the four picks. And at the end of that day of that event being called on, I was the winner. And I think it probably caught them by surprise that a local wild card at the age of 25 was going to win this event and go into being number one on the world tour, because it was the first event of the year. All of a sudden, my name's at number one for a world title. People were like, whoa. And they didn't want to give me a spot on tour, but I was like, how are you guys not going to let me compete in the other three events when I'm winning the tour? Yeah. You've only run one event. Look who's at number one. And that was my way in, squeaking through WSL and getting on tour. And yeah, they've ran 5 years, and I've won four. In the year that I didn't win, I got second. I hate saying that there was reasons, but there was injuries. I got a cortisone shot the night before the event. I had tore my meniscus and my quad and my leg the day before out at Jaws, which, I mean, it didn't affect me.
Yeah, right.
It's rough talking about that. Honestly, I hate losing. I'm so competitive. If we're playing, like, anything on here, like
ping pong,
oh my
poker,
god, like I will go until I get one victory, and then I'll drop the paddle, and then I'll walk out. But yeah, you know, that's just a little run through on fitness. And you know, that's like you know going into those four wins was like the training evolved more and more and more. You know, after the first year, I felt my body fatigue in that final. I felt my body cramp. And I've always eaten really clean. I've had a good way of dieting through the season. And I was connected with Matt Chan, who is one of the founders and creators of CrossFit. He actually, he's from Colorado. He certified Kahea for his CrossFit coaching degree. Wow. And Matt is now running, it's Train to Win. It's one of the best high performance nutrition plans in the world, worldwide. And him and his wife Cherie are on a whole nother level. The athletes that they work on, the level of people, you're talking like LeBron, Michael Phelps levels, and no surfers are working with nutritionists like this. And I was like, hey, let's give it a try. I went into weighing my food daily, giving prescriptions on how high my heart rate was, how active I was. I was counting my macros. And I came into that next year, for that year two of that second year, the Jaws event, feeling better than I was. Like, oh, I'm invincible. Like, there's nobody who's going to beat me. No chance. And I won that event the second year with like a 10 and a 9 in the final, also with a wave that ended up winning Ride of the Year. And that year for me was just like, that was like, okay, I am not going anywhere. This is where I belong. This is what I love doing. And the harder I train, the more I dissect my nutrition, the more work and positive energy I put into myself, the better the outcome is. And that's where really the training and hard work and dedication really started to be implemented.
So you literally transformed it into a science. You
For
broke
sure.
it down. You understood that surfing cannot
yeah.
be just going out there into the water and surf, especially not with big waves.
Yeah.
There needs to be a whole
regiment. I mean, it can. I've seen big wave surfers smoke a cigarette on the jet ski and jump out of the boat. Is that for me? No, that's not who I am. It's not who I represent. And I don't believe that I can I can perform at the highest level like that. And that's the thing for me is, like, I don't want to just go out there and be a part of the crowd and I'll go out there and catch a couple waves and have fun. I want to go out there and dominate every session I'm out there, whether it's a free surf session or in a jersey. Like, I want to make sure that I am at the forefront. I am the person raising the bar. I am the person pushing the limit. And training and putting myself through pain, the misery, you know, the discomfort, the late nights and early mornings of, you know, eating food that is not appealing, you know, it's like to feel those results at the end is why you do it. And it's I think fighters have like a really similar mindset and idea for it, you know, what they put themselves through training camp. And that's kind of, you know, I've always been such a big fan of martial artists and, you know, with UFC being such a fast-growing sport and some of Hawaii's fighters being at the absolute top, you know, from BJ Penn just really marking himself as the greatest of all time. And, you know, then you have the Max Holloways and the Yancy Medeiros and, you know, the list goes on and on and on. And you got the boxers, the jiu-jitsu. There's so many different sides of martial artists of where those guys go into their training camps and how they elevate themselves and how they put themselves in discomfort. Was like, why don't surfers do that?
So you basically took that approach, that mindset, and implemented into the surfing industry.
Yeah, I just felt like a lot of people, especially when I left Hawaii, like, I mean, my brother...
How many years now have you been living in the mainland?
I live here. I own a house in Pupuke on the North Shore.
No, but you were living in the mainland training with...
Yeah,
just,
I mean,
rehab, no?
Yeah, just for this year. Okay. But I spent a lot of summers there. Yeah, but you know, like when I was starting to win these big events and I was traveling and people were talking to me, my wife's brother is Bruno Mars, who I'm sure you guys all know of. And it's what, you train, you do this? And I'm like, yeah. And I just felt like people didn't have the respect for surfing as they do like other athletes. I'm right. Like, bro, I'm not like...
Yeah, you're the LeBron James of surfing.
Well, it's like, I don't want to be looked at as a beach bum or like dude, like some stony, like, you know, beach bum who, yeah, he rips, but then you see him in the parking lot drinking beers and smoking cigs, and it's like the kids, you know, the next generation, the Eli Hannemans, these up-and-coming kids are like looking at that guy like, I don't want to be him.
Right.
I didn't want that, and I felt like people outside of our industry and our sport were like, wait, you train? You have a nutritionist? Yeah. Like, wait, what? Why? And I was like, bro, surfing, like, to see surfing go to the Olympics, to see, you know, what these Gabriels, these Philippes, you know, what John, these, like, we're not surfers. We are athletes. Yeah. We are professional athletes. And I think the road that WSL has taken in the last 5 years to really promote that and respect us as those people in life has been a blessing because this is what I've been
financially
working
too, I believe.
Oh, for sure. And it's like for me, yeah, I looked up to a bunch of surfers, but I looked up to Kobe Bryant. Like that was a person for me was like, this is who I want to be. I want to work harder than anyone. And I know I've been born with some talent and a skill set, but it's that mentality of being walking in a room and looking every guy in the eye and understanding I'll outwork every one of you. And if I confidently can tell myself that, then nobody can beat me. And that's something I think that these guys like Kobe Bryant, the Conor McGregors, these people who have this relentless mentality of just never giving up and working through anything. And that's, you know, that goes back to the losses of my family and friends that I've dealt with and been through is like, it's, bro, this is all just part of my map. This is part of my map to the end. And, you know, it's the nutrition and training has snowballed so much. I mean, 2 years ago.
And I think you also own your own gym up on the North Shore?
Yeah. So, I mean, like last year, I was like, you know, Kahe has his gym. He's trained me incredibly well. And I'll never, ever stop training under him. You know, there'll never be a day I outgrow Kahe because he's still applying new techniques daily to me. And I just wanted to build myself a home gym. And it was honestly like a little shoebox. I had an assault bike, a tiny squat rack, about four sets of dumbbells, maybe two or three kettlebells, a foam roller.
A foam roller.
Yeah, like a few little things. And it was a shed on the house that we had bought in Pupukea. And that went from being like a little shoebox, my little home gym, to like, yeah, let's put a little overhang and expand it. And then, okay, cool. And that went by. And then 6 months later, I was like, you know, babe, let's make it a little bigger than this. I really like this. And then, you know, now we're, you know, fast forward a couple of years. It's been a blessing in disguise after I went through my injury to have this facility. I've created, you know, a state-of-the-art training facility. It's pretty good size. It's about 30 by 40 feet. It's fully insulated. I mean, there's over $250,000 in equipment in there. And, you know, from using metabolic breath analyzers to, you know, everything, every kind of machine. Assault bike has helped me out. Total Fitness USA here in Honolulu has helped us big time with designing it. And, you know, I've went around the world. I've trained with the best. And when I come home to get ready for winter, you know, there's nobody better than Kahea Hart who really just who gets me to where I need to be. And, you know, having that home gym up and now turning it into, you know, a public gym where my wife is teaching classes and, you know, it's Uproar Fitness.
Yeah, your wife is a certified
spin instructor. Yeah. She's also a personal trainer. She's studied a lot in fitness. And yeah, it's incredible. Our relationship, everything is so much better since fitness has really submerged itself. And, yeah. You know, 2 years ago, I've just been really obsessed with recovery and taking care of my body as much as the pain I like putting it through. I like to give back. And Laird, who's been a mentor to me my whole life, has been preaching recovery. You know, like people a few years ago looked at him taking these ice baths and doing all this hyperventilation and breath work. Like, this guy's crazy, getting in a sauna at 240 degrees for 20 minutes and then, you know, sitting in ice baths for 10 minutes and all this. And I was like, hey, I want to, you know, you have XPT, which is, you know, Laird's version of CrossFit. It's performance breath work. It's pool training underwater with weights. I was like, hey, I want to take the coaching certification course. He's like, are you serious? He's like, are you done surfing? I was like, no, but I want to be able to share what you're giving. I want to share that to my people. I want to, and I also want to elevate myself. I think it's a category that I haven't really broken the seal on. It's still something I'm so new to, and took the course, a few days of testing, some physical testing, and I got my coaching certification. And it's something that I definitely preach, and it's something I practice daily.
You're passionate about it, I can tell.
I'm very passionate.
I can tell you, Billy, when this whole surfing career is over, it sounds like you're going to move into that direction.
For sure.
I wish people can see your face. You're glowing as you're talking about it.
People try to tell me that I overwork, and that pisses me off so much. I laugh. I'm like, you guys think I overwork? You think I. No.
Go meet Laird.
I take care. Even Laird, he doesn't overwork, he works hard. But the amount that he gives back to his body and soul, mentally and physically, is next to none. And that's what I'm trying to implement. When I'm around Uncle Laird, I got my notepad out and I'm all ears. I never talk over. I ask questions consistently and I keep writing things down. And I just log that stuff. You know, I got in the memory bank of, you know, he's 57, I'm 30 years old. There's no way he was doing what I'm doing. And the amount of knowledge and, you know, the hunger I have towards fitness and taking care of your body, it's really hard to believe that anyone is there right now as an athlete, because I feel like most athletes see success and they just want to do what they do on the field. Like, it's a football player that's going to want to play ball. Surfers are going to want to surf. But it's like, I want to learn about fitness. I want to learn how to get my body to where it can't break in big waves, to where, you know, I can overcome any wave that breaks on my head, where I can, you know, surf however many heats it takes in 60-foot waves to win.
So let me ask you this. So what made you choose to go, you know, put your life on the line and choose big wave surfing versus, you know, not small, but like, you know, regular being on the tour or whatever? Like, what made you? Is it the adrenaline? Is it like?
Well, this is a great way to put it.
You put your life on the line
for sure.
Every time you go to Jaws, I mean,
Well, you know, it's like, for one, I love surfing small waves. I mean, you said I got the award right here. It was shoulder high wave with my son. I love competing, and whether it's in 2 feet or 60 feet, I truly love competing, and I love surfing. And it's like, whatever the conditions are that day, I'll figure out a way to have fun and just really enjoy myself in the water. But as far as big wave surfing, you know, growing up on Maui, there's, I mean, it's anywhere in Hawaii. There's no professional, like, sporting games where, like, if you're a kid living in L.A., your parents can take you to a Laker game, a Clippers game, a Dodgers game, Angels. You have all these, you know, hockey, whatever. We didn't have that here. But about, you know, between 1 and 5 times a year, these storms during the northern, like, during the winter would come and create these waves that were massive in Hawaii. And as somebody, a kid who surfed and loved having an older brother who was a professional surfer and just having a really, you know, unique attachment to the ocean, my family would take me up on those big days to watch Jaws from the cliff. It's kind of like an arena, watching it from the shoreline there. And at the beginning days, you know, in the mid-90s, when I was right around 5 years old, there was a crew of guys, the Strap crew, the pioneers, the OGs of Jaws, and taking surfing, big wave surfing, to the next level, which was Laird Hamilton, Derek Donner, Dave Kalama, Buzzy Kerbox, I mean, Brian Kailana, Pete Cabrina, the list goes on and on and on. And those guys, you know, like, watching Laird surf when I was 5 years old, I was watching Superman or Spider-Man. Like, that's literally how I looked at it. Like, that was my Dodger Stadium or Staples Center. Like, that was it for me. I was like, holy shit, I'm going to be that guy one day. I'm going to ride that wave. And my parents were like, yeah, right. Like, and get out of here. Like, stop. That's going to kill you. Like, that's not where you belong. You know, these guys are stupid. They're out of their mind. They're the only guys doing this. You know, they're using Zodiacs and speedboats to whip them in on huge boards. Their equipment was all trial and error. They were just trying, seeing what worked and what didn't.
Wait, so back in the day, they used to pull someone into the wave on a Zodiac?
Bro, they, yeah. Laird guys tried. Wow. They used everything. They
really,
were,
tell them the size of the board they used to get towed in.
Oh, I mean, they were the beginning days, is they were using, like, Waimea guns, holding on behind a speedboat, a camouflage spray-painted speedboat, barely having enough speed, no foot straps, leash on, in board shorts that were so short your balls could probably hang out of. Like, these guys were...
Waimea gun start like at least 9'6" and up, right, Billy?
Yeah,
like
these, are not
these things are like
tow boards.
Giant,
now.
Yeah.
You now the way tow boards are built now are, you know, compressed carbon fiber. They're 30 pounds, they're 1 inch thick by 16 inches wide and 5.5 feet long. It's a different game now. You know, it's like they were just like on the fly, what works and what doesn't. And, you know, what doesn't kill you only makes you stronger. And, you know, those were the days. That right there is what drew me to wanting to surf big waves. It was like, okay, there's no, like, superheroes or action figures that I was obsessed with when I was a kid. I didn't have, like, a little Superman toy. I, like, had a vision of Laird and Double D and Dave Kalama of, like, one day I'm going to be that guy. And... honestly, like, my brother...
Did you have a poster in your room?
I had everything. Yeah. I had every photo of Laird. Yeah, everything. I used to draw pictures in my composition book, and all my friends would draw these waves in their book. And my wave would always be, like, the whole paper, and the surfer would be like an ant. And I was like, I want to surf a 100-foot barrel. Like,
What was the highest wave you ever...
Oh, man, I hate that question, because it's like, you know, how... I just have such a hard time understanding the measurement of a wave, you know? For me, it's like, fuck.
How do you measure it then?
Once the waves get past, like, I'm 20-foot Hawaiian, which is like a 40-foot face, once the waves get that big, I'm just like, it's fucking big, you know?
Yeah.
I don't know. It's 25 to 30 feet, you know? It's 40 to 60-foot faces out there.
Well, let's say it that way. Where was the biggest wave you ever rode?
Jaws. Jaws is the pinnacle. Yeah. You know, Nazare is...
So is it the one beach you, like, you respect
there,
the most?
It's not even me. It's, I don't care who you are. There's other waves that might be taller. There's no wave that is pound for pound equivalent to what Jaws is. Not even close.
Have you surfed Naz?
Yes, I have. Yeah. I've paddled Nazare a few times in New Jersey. And... You know, it's a average paddle wave. I mean, it's cool, but you're not going to get a big barrel paddle surfing.
Right.
I think if your goal in life is to ride the tallest wave ever, then you should probably go live in Portugal for half the year and just tow surf out there, because
you do it.
There's without a doubt 100-foot faced waves, but Jaws has never gotten too big.
Yep.
The bigger it gets, the better it gets. And, you know, I've seen 80-foot faced waves out there going top to bottom and spitting three sections on one wave. So it's like, that is what draws my attention. Height, yeah, it's great. It gets your adrenaline up. But I want to ride waves like I ride at pipe. You know, it's like when I'm serving a heat at pipe, I want to go on a 10-foot backdoor wave and get blown out into the channel. That's the sensation I'm chasing. And that's escalated to out of Jaws of, I don't know how it happened or when it happened, but all of a sudden I'm trying to get the deepest barrel I can, you know, out of Jaws at the pinnacle of big wave surfing. So big wave surfing, it really was a snowball effect. It just, you know, same way as fitness, it's like you get a taste and you can't get enough.
I think when it comes to that size, I think of Kelly, and I think actually more Shane than Kelly and
yeah.
you. I mean, you guys... You and Shane have this ability to read the waves so fucking good, right? Don't you think?
I mean, Shane is like,
I mean it's like it's
for
it's,
me. I call Shane like the Godfather. He's like Tony Montana to me. You know? Like, he's the kingpin. Like I straight up tell Shane, I'm like, bro, you're the kingpin. For me, there's nobody. You know, there's nobody who's done what Shane has out there.
Right.
Aside from Laird. Laird did it for the strap crew. He started it.
Right.
And then. Yeah, there was a couple guys who went out there and paddled. Cool, great. They got a couple cool rides. Yeah. Shane went out there and said, I'm going to go surf Jaws the way I surf backdoor my whole career. I was just like...
And get shacked.
He gave two shits about how big the wave was or going straight. He was like, I'm going to look for the cleanest, biggest barrel. And he rode it like he rides backdoor. And that's what drew my attention. I was like,
yeah,
all hail... You, Shane-o. Like, Shane is the boss. He is, he's a man, the myth, the legend. And it's really cool to see where he's at now in life, you know, like seeing him transition out of that mentality and push all that energy towards just giving his son such a good platform.
Yeah,
he's the one guy who's not like a soccer dad coach. Like, Jackson, you got to get out there. He's like, what do you want to do today, Jackson? He's like, I want to surf. He's like, great. Let me know how long you want to surf. I'll film you. Wherever you want to go, you want to surf tiny beach break or you want to go surf big waves, you just tell me. And I have so much love and respect for that because I was not like my, you know, the people above me when I was younger were so harsh and pushing and you can't lose this and that. And it's like, I see that. And I see how it wears off on kids and I see the way Shane is grooming his son. And it's like, Shane's all, I'm so inspired by that guy and way more on the on land than in the water. And my motivation and inspiration from him in the water is more than any other surfer. So as a father, you can only imagine how much that guy inspires me.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
So go ahead.
No.
I'm just so excited. I just want to know. I just want to talk about Morocco.
yeah.
You know,
we gotta go there.
All my buddies, let's go. Okay.
Before you tell me
about Morocco, that year you had a fantastic year.
Yeah.
You have an amazing year. Everything is good. Like you have you win right and right in the beginning of the year.
I just felt it was such a crazy year. I worked harder than I've ever worked. I just wanted. For me, my goal is like, you know, the Triple Crown to me is like a world title. Like, I want a Triple Crown so bad, and I'm not going to let go until I get it. And I was like, you know, I feel great. My boards, equipment, everything felt amazing. And I just, Mother Nature didn't cooperate on a few opportunities with me during the Triple Crown. I put together probably the best performance I ever have here in Hawaii. Like, you know, every heat dropping sevens, eights, and nines. And, you know, from 3-foot Haliva to 12-foot Sunset to going into winning the pipe trials, which is an event on its own, and then jumping into the CT event of the pipe masters. My first heat was with Italo, and I comboed him right out the back. I was like, my confidence was through the roof. And the next day, unfortunately, I came up against Hawaii's own Seth Moniz, and he got the better of me on the first exchange, and it was just like kind of a battle for sixes and sevens. And you know, he was a better man that day. He won, and I tipped my hat to him. And I literally went from there straight to my house in Pupukea, grabbed my backpack that I packed the night before, and this is literally the day after the trials, too. I had won the trials the day before that. I'd surfed 5 heats that day, then went and surfed 2 heats of the Pipe Masters and got in my car, drove to the airport, went to the, landed on Maui at like 4 or 5 p.m., went to the surfers meeting, checked in, got all my stuff ready, and the next morning I was competing at one of the best days we've ever had out at Jaws, and to go on to win my fourth title out there, you know, that was just like, I really felt great. Like, you know, all the hard work, as much as I wanted a triple crown, I just felt like I succeeded, like I got something that I wanted. But I didn't get it all. Like, there was a little bit of bitterness. There's a little emptiness. And
yeah.
I took my family on a crazy snowboard trip, just like a full vacation. I felt like I deserved to relax and kind of put everything aside, turned my phone over for a week and spent time with my family and during the holidays up in the snow, and came home to the Sunset Open and at out at Sunset Beach, a QS event, first QS of the year, and I went straight into winning that event. And the day after that event, I flew to Maui and rode the best wave of my entire life out at Jaws, which just recently won my second ride of the year victory, which was huge. That wave was the most monumental wave of my life. You know, there's no wave that's ever done that to me ever.
It looked like you knew it's one of the best, because once you got out of there, like, you knew
for sure. And that day, like, you know, the adrenaline and the endorphins that were released out of my body when you overcome something that you visualize and manifested your whole life, like, all that manifesting and visualizing was like, poof, like, it's possible, it's done, like, I did it. And that was just like unbelievable. At this point, you know, I'm basically feeling somewhat unstoppable. I went into the Vulcan Pipe Pro, boom, came out firing, had an insane heat, and the final day was dog shit, 2 foot onshore, not pipe. You know, it wasn't the conditions I was expecting to surf. I ended up losing, and Koa Smith had texted me, one of my best friends, because he had lost the day before. He's like, Bill, what do we do now? And I just remember telling him, like, let's go really, really far away and get barreled with nobody around. And he's like, haha, like, joking around. And literally, like, the next morning I'd woken up to a text from a friend by the name of Jerome Shoyum. And he is basically, if I could explain him, he's like the Moroccan Laird. this guy's got so much adrenaline and just amazing hospitality and great vibe to him. And I kind of gave him a pretty good introduction out at Jaws a few years back, just made him feel really comfortable, tied him up with the best safety guys. And he just told me, you know, when you have a gap in your window, come to my home and I want to show you around. I've never been to Northern Africa, and that swell, WSL, had hit me up and they're like, hey, we're going to run the towing event out at Nazaré. Your spots, you know, we want to book your tickets. And I was like, I'm not going to do it. And they're like, wait, what? And I was like, you know, for me to fly over there and tow surf, something that I've just not lost love for, but it's not what I'm focusing on, to fly over there and surf waves that have a really good chance of, you know, killing me, ending me, to win like $5,000. It's just like, my love is not for going straight on big waves. Yeah. Like, I want to surf big barrels. And I declined my entry and was like, but I am going to go. I'm looking at going to Northern Africa, to Morocco. And WSL was like, no way. Can we send a team with you and document it and create a cool content piece, like a strike mission? I was like, yeah, let's do it. So I rang up Koa Smith. I called him back, and I called Luke Davis. I was like, hey, you guys want to go with me to Morocco and score some waves? And they're like, hell yeah. So, you know, that momentum of that year was, you know, it was a hand of cards that you'll never be dealt with again in your career. You know, it's like, I might chase that role and that rhythm forever. If I get it, fuck, I hope I do. You know, I'll never give up, knock on wood, that I can get back to it. But, yeah, you know, it was the internal feelings I had going on through last year and the confidence mentally and physically that I was going through was unrelatable. It was undeniably something that I didn't even know existed. And when I got a taste of it, I was just like a man on a mission. And I seen this swell going to Morocco, and I was like, let's go. Let's keep the ball rolling. Let's, like, whether it's free surfing or competitive surfing, I want to be at the forefront. I want to be putting out the best content. I want to be riding the best waves in the world. And we
just
had...
Just so you know, everybody that I know that is surfing was asked me to ask you where it was, because it nowhere it says. They say it's a sweet.
Ain't gonna happen. Why do you always ask where do you serve what spot? I go, duh.
It was in northern Africa, in Morocco, around. There's a pretty well known wave called Safi, a right point, and right around that area. Incredible waves. We go down there and we're on. We went for a 5-day trip. There was a swell. We get there like 2 days before. Boom, we go straight into scoring perfect waves. It was about, 4 to 6 foot Hawaiian, 10 to 12 foot faces, and just rifling 20 second backdoor waves.
Yeah.
Incredible. Best barrels ever. Like, unbelievable trip.
Is it like Market River? Is it like
no, it's more like reverse Skeleton Bay, like the movie.
Wow.
Like psychotic. Like holy it makes shit. Kira and like the Superbanks look like
nothing.
Like nothing. I'm talking like
reverse
Skeleton Bay.
Co would know.
Way bigger, way heavier, way thicker. Like legit. And coming to the end of those 5 days, there's a swell on the back end that's like about 5 days out. That's three times as big, massive. And I'm just like, oh my God, this is like Jerome, the guys down there, like, hey, there's been nothing like this in 20 years. Along with the tides are beyond negative. They're the lowest tides we've ever seen. And lining up the timing, the coefficient, the period of the swell, everything was like, he was like, you could not write down a better swell right now. He's like, you can't leave. I called my wife. I was like, babe, I was planning on coming back to Africa, later on in the year, but I'm here already and there's another swell. It makes sense I just stay, right? And she's like, whatever, just stay, you got to do what you got to do. We stayed and best trip of my life, unbelievable. We're just scoring the best waves ever. And the last day of
how
the
many
trip,
hours a day you surf?
Fuck, that big swell, it was the second day of it, the biggest day of it. And I got in the water that day at 8 a.m. and at 5:30, we were moving, kind of heading back in. And
how many guys in the water total? How many guys in the lineup?
Most of the time, it was just us.
That's it.
To ourselves.
Just three of us.
No one.
Yeah, that's it.
No one.
How big? Just for shit and giggles. Whatever.
Majority, like, that day, between 10 and 15 foot faces. And, like, but I'm talking, like,
dredging.
Maybe even, like, 20 foot faces, Actually, yeah, for sure. There was the big day. I would say like between 15 to 25 foot faced waves and 15 to 30 second backdoor underground dredging barrels, like psychotic. And 5:30, we're about to head in and we've seen this couple of these waves come in and I was like, man, should we get one more? And they're like,
you were tired.
Let's go. So
smart.
I'd taken two water breaks out of 9.5 hours, and I didn't step on land once. I was in the ocean in my wetsuit the whole time. I paddle back out, the rotation's gone, I'm waiting my turn, I'm up to bat, and Jerome, this set comes in, Jerome's like, this is the wave of the day. Like, this is the fucking wave. I got a really easy line into it, pulled in up on the top, like this high barrel, and the whole wave just started like rifling across the sand and just started coming back at me. And it was kind of like when you see Waimea shore break, like, it goes below sea level. Mm-hmm. It was doing that, and I was like, oh my God. I was kind of on a longer board, and I was trying to keep the nose of my board out, but also stall to get myself real deep. And there's a rock at this wave. There's one rock on the whole point that's kind of exposed, but majority, when this wave breaks, it's never this big. This is a swell of 20 years, and I was taking off way behind where people normally take off, and I'm shedding all this speed, trying to keep my board engaged. It's so steep, it's sucking up so much water that I have to keep my board going straight and my outside edge caught. And I went over the falls, and when I went up, it went like just silent. And just like I was in a cloud and just poosh, just straight
into. Did you have a vest on at all?
Straight into a rock. I was wearing a wetsuit with flotation built in, like pads. Yeah. And I hit the right side of my body basically from my quadricep to my mid ribs, and when I hit, I knocked out cold out, and I was completely unconscious, not lack of oxygen, like knockout, punch knockout, like being hit from impact. And I had flotation on my suit, and as I surfaced, I kind of could start to see, and my vision came really clear, and I heard the craziest ringing and like these crazy noises in my head, and I couldn't move my body, and I was like, oh my God, I'm paralyzed. I'm like just try to breathe. I had the wind knocked out of me. You know, I didn't even know what was wrong at this point. And, you know, as I'm like, I have my head above the water, I slowly am starting able to breathe, and somebody came up and grabbed me. And when they grabbed me, my body released. And that's when I was like, oh my God, something is wrong. A pain undescribable. And, you know, what happened was I collapsed my right lung. I broke my pelvis in half from the top all the way down into my joint line, and in my joint line with where my femur, my hip sits in, my femur, my hip had come out because my pelvis snapped off and was floating in my ass cheek. And where I hit the rock on my quadricep, it split my quad muscle in half. And the impact and the push from the wave when hitting the rock tore my ACL and my right knee in half, my MCL in half, and my meniscus to shreds. And, you know, I didn't know what I was going through. I just felt this internal pain, which was my pelvis, of when I moved in the water, I felt my body going like this. Like, I could feel my crotch,
flexing.
Like, my insides. Like, if you grab me like this, you could just open me. Like, legit, like, I felt like there was no stability, and my knee felt like a boiled noodle. My leg was, my knee joint was completely in half, and they got me onto the jet ski and, you know, got me into...
But where it happened is a rundown place. Like, it's not like... it's like third world.
Like, industrial desert, like, the gnarliest port fishing village, like, in the middle of nowhere.
What go through your mind? Like, you're in pain.
Like, right here, I get on this jet ski and I'm in survival mode. Like, I'm literally thinking that just, like, get to a hospital and survive. Like, I don't know. I have no blood on me, but I've never been in pain like this in my life. I know something internally is so fucked up that I'm just like, you know, hold on. And, you know, I ended up, you know, getting myself... Like, I mean, I didn't get myself. They got me onto the jet ski, get me into the harbor, which, a blessing from God, there's a massive fishing, a commercial port, like a massive harbor where they bring in big barges and unload all this. It was like where they manufacture a bunch of these chemicals. So the town was so polluted and gnarly and illegal to come into the harbor. There's guys standing with, you know, machine guns, like federal... I don't even know what they are, not saying like, hey, you will get arrested. And my friend Jerome's like, it's an emergency, we're coming in. We come in, an ambulance meets us there, they get me on a stretcher. And the transition of getting me onto a stretcher, for anyone listening to this, it's like, anybody who's broken their pelvis has an understanding. Like, just think of having a broken pelvis and being in the ocean and having nothing, like, you can't, there's no stable surface. You're moving. To move your body when your pelvis is in half, you know, you lose more blood count like that than you do getting shot. You know, I lost half my blood count. I had three blood, like, I mean, you know, blood transfusions, everything. You know, it's like I had no strength in me. And they got me into an ambulance, took me to this hospital that was fucking radical. Like,
when you say radical, like in the movies, there's nothing.
Like, it's a like horror movie. Like shit you see in scary movies. Like an old cafeteria with gravel, dirt floors in some areas. Ladies giving birth on the floor. People screaming bloody murder. No windows.
This is a hospital.
I mean, you could call it one. No hospital beds. Yeah. Like nothing. No rooms, no dividers. There's people, just blood everywhere. Their x-ray machine was in an old bathroom. So they take me in there on the stretcher. I'm screaming in pain, like going in and out of fainting, like barely holding on. And it was so dirty that they couldn't even give me like any sort of morphine. They couldn't give me any injections, nothing. They're like, no pain. It was so dirty that my friend Jerome was like, we can't let them give you anything.
From fear of infection.
Oh, yeah. You don't even trust the doctors. Like, what's in that thing? But they're like, we need to see an x-ray to see what's going on. And we're literally holding this x-ray up to like a light. I'm on a bed just holding on for dear life in my wetsuit, like, You know, they're starting to cut my wetsuit down the middle and slowly peel it off me. And they can see on this x-ray, it was like, it was so blurry and so distorted, but you could see this crack. It looked like a lightning bolt going down my pelvis, and they're like, it's his pelvis, it's broken. And my knee was blown to smithereens, and they're over there trying to, his knee looks fine. I'm just like holding my breath, like going in and out of blacking out. These people have no idea, like, you know, what's going on right now. And luckily, you know, Jerome, the man that he is, he's just, you know, he really runs the show down there. His program is next to none. It's incredible. And his wife and him organize, like, you know, the best hospital in Morocco, in Casablanca, with a really good doctor. And they had like a legit ambulance there right away. Boom, throw me in the ambulance. Me and Jerome go basically around 4 hours to this other hospital, put me in there. And it was, fuck, it was a wild ride in that hospital of just getting an understanding of all these injuries.
How was your wife in that time? I mean, she probably is going insane, nuts.
Yeah. Yeah, and this is all stuff, like, the documentary that we're doing at WSL Studios, like, you know, if people are interested in this injury and what I went through, like, in detail, like, we filmed everything. It's,
this,
like,
is ins-
like, the hospitals in Morocco.
Oh, you have it on video. Oh, what,
dude,
the
my
fuck?
Surgeries, my stem cell treatments, you know, everything. My family, my wife, you
this
know.
This is one of the most incredible stories.
So it led into, like, me being in really rough condition to where, like, I couldn't breathe on my own. My lungs were filling with fluid. I had secondary.
So one side failed, like, lung
gone. And they wouldn't in their country, they don't drain lungs, and my lungs were filling with fluid, which I'm getting pneumonia. It literally sounded like a bong or a fish tank, like bubbling water when I was breathing, like,
oh my god.
Like, and you could hear it rising to where the third night I was like, and I stopped breathing, and they took me in the ICU, finally put me on oxygen. My doctors here in California are like freaking out, like, this kid is going to die, you have to drain his lungs. Like, we don't perform that in our country. So with, you know, with the support of WSL and, you know, what they did, they you know, through the 3 days of figuring out where I'm gonna go, do I go to France and get emergency surgery, do I do this, do I do that, they figured out that, you know, not to mention COVID's hitting right now.
Oh shit.
So borders are closing, like gates shutting people out, like a
lot. This is March or February?
This is the very February 28th.
Oh my god.
And so they're like, fuck, if it's not emergency surgery, let's fucking, we're sending a private jet, we're gonna send two doctors from Paris to be on the team to medevac him home. And fuck, we went from, so on the fourth night, I started my trip home with Co Smith. He stayed with me and flew on the private jet with me, and I went from Morocco to Bordeaux, France, Bordeaux, France to Greenland, Greenland to Canada, get to Canada.
Holy fuck. And
fucking LAX Customs shuts our entry down because of COVID. So I'm like, I can't get into the U.S. We tried San Bernardino, they shut us down. San Diego, they shut us down.
What, are you driving or flying there?
Flying. We have a private jet. It was like, I mean, this was a heavy situation.
Yeah, yeah, you know? For sure. And
by the grace of God, Van Nuys opened their customs and let us in. Get me there, go to LA, I see my family. I went straight into surgery for my pelvis, and, you know, about 3 weeks later than that, they did a knee reconstructive surgery on me, put back together my knee, stem cell treatments, and all.
How many stem cell treatments did you have?
Five different injections.
What do you think about it?
Incredible. You know, that's the future of this. Yeah. And my doctor is an orthopedic surgeon, Mossy Reynolds, out of San Jose, in sports medicine. He works with Golden State Warriors, San Francisco Giants, 49ers, unbelievable. He is my family. He is not my doctor. Like, he's a brother to me, and he took the responsibility of being like my medical director for this whole trip and calling the shots. I called him and told him, I was like, hey, I don't have the energy. I can't. You got to help Tahiti. You got to help me. I trust in you. Find the right doctor for my pelvis, because he is knee and shoulder only. He's in Silicon Valley in San Jose. And this point, we have a crazy team of doctors working together and people, you know, Laird and Gabby Hamilton, my wife, you know, WSL, Eric Logan, Dirk, like the owners and people, you know, Pat O'Connell, everyone, there's a team involved in finding the a specialist who can put back my pelvis to where I'd be able to even walk. Because in Morocco, the surgery that they were going to perform would have got me to walking, but they said it would have limited me to ever running or riding a bike again, let alone ever surfing. So that was like, okay, we got to do research on finding, we have to send these x-rays, MRIs, everything to these doctors, where's blood's at, everything, how much time do we have, our nerves being damaged, everything, to finding the right person to get me back to, you know, I was like, fuck, I want to go back. Like, I don't want to be that person who is like that, you know, that story of what if, you know. I didn't want to be the what if. I wanted to be the because. I wanted kids to look at me and be like, oh, because Billy did it, I can do it. You know, that's why I did it. And my team of doctors, you know, created a formula and positioned me with the best medical advice and physicians, you know, surgeons, you name it. And right now we're about 7 months post surgery, and I've went under 4 times since then, and had a handful of stem cell treatments, PRP, ozone.
What is PRP?
They pull your own blood, yeah. They spin it, they get the blood plasma, the white blood cells out, and they inject it in you, and it does wonders. My body reacts really well to it, and.
But I met you randomly in June on the beach, and you were already surfing. You remember that? In Waikiki, you were already surfing.
That was my first wave back. So,
wow.
So that was like unofficially. I mean, I was on a longboard. I went surfing, and I went tandem with my wife on my first wave back. And it was such a big hurdle for me. It felt so good, and especially it was on Father's Day is what it was. Oh, no, wait.
Yeah, it was.
It was. I came home because I've been living in California. I've been doing all my physical therapy and training. I've been living with Laird Hamilton up there, and you know, going. I go. You know, like I said, Kobe Bryant inspired me so much that I found a way to get into the Mamba Academy and do all my therapy there, because I truly believe the people that he positioned himself around with must be the best in the world, and they
100%.
Are 100%. Without a doubt. Yeah. They're incredible. And you know, I came home for my son and my wife's birthday, June 1st and June 2nd, and also Father's Day. I left the day after Father's Day, and I told my wife, like, hey, I think I want to try catch a wave on Father's Day. And she's like, you're crazy. Like, you shouldn't. I was like, okay, well, then let's go out, and I'll just lay down. You can lay on. She doesn't surf. She can stand up in the front of this. Borrowed a board from the Moniz Surf School, like a 12-foot stand-up paddle. And we paddle for this wave, and we're going, and we're on the wave, and I'm laying down, and she's standing up. And I have a GoPro in my mouth, and I didn't even tell her, and I just stood up, and I was just like, babe, and she like kind of turned over her shoulder. She's like, holy shit.
How did it feel?
It just felt, and like there was like a couple people who knew me, who were like some old local Hawaiian guys stand up paddling out at Queens, and like, Billy, and they knew. They were just like, I could hear people yelling my name. It was such a big moment for me. It was kind of just like, you know, if there's a way, there's a will. You know, as I found my of way of getting there. So that was the first step in the right direction.
I only have 2 questions, and you can end the show, because number one, I think you should have your own podcast. No, seriously, Billy, you're so articulate, and you have so beautiful, and when you share your story, it's so genuine. I feel that, you know, I think you should do your own podcast. Anyway, my first question is, at which moment you become spiritual? Is it your mother with cancer? Is it when a lion fights for his life? Or any other moment? I'm curious, because I think there's a shift in you.
Yeah.
And I'm trying to figure out what that moment, because you're so young. And for you to be where you are today, I'm super impressed, man. You're like brilliant.
Yeah, you know, it was my mom told me, saying, you know, all I had to do to win the world title was beat Kailani. And if he got 6th place, I need to get 5th place. I was like a point. And he was ahead of me by like a couple points. And all I had to do was beat him by 1 spot. And my mom was diagnosed with stage 4 throat cancer. And giving very limited time to basically live. I was like, you know, Mom, I'm gonna take some time off. Lion wasn't even a year old yet. He was just a little guy, and I was like, you know what? I'm just gonna take the year off, and I'm gonna hang out. I'm gonna help you around the house, and I'm gonna do everything I can, and we're gonna beat this fight. And she looked at me one day. I didn't even tell her the contest was a thing, because I was like, I'm not gonna go to Nazareth. Whatever it is, what it is, I can run the event. Kailani will win the world title. And she's like, so when are you leaving? I was at her house helping her with some stuff. She's in and just like basically, you know, useless. She couldn't really do much. And I was like, to where? And she's like, to Nazareth. I was like, I'm not going. I'm just gonna stay back. And she's like, why? And she's like, I just told her, I was like, I want to spend time with you. And she was like, well, you know, you being weak makes me weak. And she's like, you've been really weak around me. You know, you've been crying, you've been really emotional, and it's bringing me down, and it's making my days harder. And I was like, well, I'm trying to be strong. I'm trying to do everything I can for you. You know, I'm your servant. I'm doing, you want me to, you know, go to the store. What do you want me to do? And she was just like, I want you to go do what I taught you what to do. And I was like, well, what's that? And she's like, I taught you to love Mother Nature. I taught you to respect the ocean. I taught you to enjoy yourself and have fun and do what you love. And she's like, you know, whatever you do in life, once you find something that you truly enjoy, I want you to be passionate about it. And she's like, go compete. Go do what you love doing. And she's like, when you stop, I stop. If you stop going, if you stop surfing, I'm going to stop fighting. And I was like, fuck. I literally put on the Eminem song, Till I Collapse, and listened to it probably 1,500 times on 40 hours of traveling to get to Portugal, and did not give myself another option but beating Kailani and winning the world title. Like, legitimately. And it was, I did not win that day, my mom did, and the conditions were horrible, the waves sucked, but I literally, all I could think about, like, was my mom and getting to that point for her. And yeah, you know, I think that just doing something for somebody who did everything for you is like, it's the ultimate feeling of giving back, and that to me is the most memorable moment of my life. You know, along with being a father, it's like, my mom was the best mom ever, and I got to show her my children. She was there for the birth of my kids, and you know, she watched my kids fight, she watched my kids grow up, and to show her that I'm going to continue our legacy, to continue our blood, to give our family more chances at changing the world, at motivating, inspiring people. You know, now I'm doing it. My kid, like, we have more opportunity with our kids on earth to help and give back. And you know, it's like, without my mom, there's none of my kids. You know, without my mom, there's none of me. And that's like, people always ask, like, what is that moment? And it's like, you know, it's the moment of my mom. My mom brought me here. My mom did everything for me. My mom was my mom and dad. My dad basically just abandoned me, and just horrible relationship ended with me and my mom. Like, it's just, it was bad. And my mom was everything to me, and she still is. And my children know that, my friends know that. And you know, I wear it, and I'm proud of it, and I talk about it, because it's like, you know, a lot of people are hard. It's hard for them to talk about. It's hard for them to understand that, you know, your mom's fighting a fucking disease that can't be cured, but we can fucking send people to space and walk on fucking other planets. But you're telling me you can't cure a fucking disease that's been around for decades?
Yeah.
But you got all these pills that fucking can do anything.
Yeah.
Anything. You're telling me that the president of the United States cannot come up with a formula? It's a bunch of bullshit, and it really, like, it makes me angry, to be honest with you. And it's, you know, that's kind of why I've talking about it and just expressed myself and really opened up on being very grateful for the time that I've had with my mom, and just even having a mom, because, you know, I didn't have the greatest dad growing up, and I know people who didn't have moms growing up, and I had a mom for 28 years of just incredibleness. Not a bad day. Not a day I wanted somebody else to be my mom. every single day I woke up so fucking happy and lucky that I got to see my mom and call this beautiful woman mom. Like, it was everything I ever, anything I needed, she was there for me. And yeah, I was happy to show her my children, you know, to show her that I'm gonna be a father, a husband, and continue our legacy of representing our family with pride and joy.
Incredible, truly. I'm not gonna ask the second one, cause yeah. Hey, listen.
You already answered.
No, because I mean, the second one, yeah. Nah, I'm a, Billy, I mean, it's you know, it's like, you're like, if you look at all the greatness, right? Maybe not Kobe, because I think Kobe and his father relationship was fairly close, but you look at Kelly, look at you, look at all great men like Tyson, you look at all these great, great. They all have this one thing, common denominator, like the missing male role figure, right? You look at the momentum generation, you even look at Shane, you look at everyone. And they took all that hurt, right? All that neglect, right? And they put it into that passion. That's the key. And every one of these men and women, it's not just, you know, they fucking figure out that passion early on.
Yeah.
And then they just fuse this obsession, right, toward this thing called passion, and they create greatness. And at the end of every single one of these men or women, it's the same thing. Because now, realizing what a blessing life that you have at 30. I mean, I'm tripping out. The shit come out of your mouth at 30. Mm-hmm. It's just tripping me out. I'm 56 and have you this. And because of where you came from, the father you are today, whoo, brah, that's going to be your legacy. Not the big wave riding, because the men you are to your children, to your four beautiful children. Billy, I'm a bigger fan now. Yeah, before I got here.
I was a huge fan.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm even a bigger fan.
Incredible, Billy.
We're gonna wrap it up. Tomorrow you're flying into California tomorrow morning. Before we're gonna finish, there's this thing that we do. we have five what would you rather questions.
Okay,
to Billy Kemper.
Fire them off. Let's go.
All right, guys, I hope you guys ready. What would you rather, travel with your whole family for 3 weeks or travel just with your wife for 3 days?
My whole family. It's, you know, that's a hard question. My wife might hate me for that. Right now would be a great time to travel with just me and my wife. It's been rough, you know, and I think for her too. She's, you know, without her, me returning to surfing wouldn't be possible, because she's allowed me to basically live without the family in California for the last 6 months and strictly work on getting myself back to performing for this winter. So
she's definitely one of the strongest.
Yeah, you know what? We just took the family on a 3-week incredible trip. I took them to the surf ranch, all that stuff. So I think right now it'd be a little time for mom and dad to go sneak off.
3 days.
Right on.
Three days.
Yeah. All right. Second question. What would you rather, live poor on the beach till you're 120 or filthy rich till you're 60?
Live poor on the beach. I'm 120. And honestly, it's not the number of days and we live. It's just about the moment. And to be on the beach, the moment's there. So that's all I need.
Right on. What would you rather, be a world famous belly dancer or an unknown break dancer?
I think unknown break dancer. Hey, you know who's an unknown break dancer? Shane Dorian.
No way!
I think he won like a state championship contest when he was younger.
No.
Like, hey, world class. Shane, if you watch
Dorian.
This,
oh
I broke
God.
The seal. I always do. And we've been on a couple podcasts and interviews together, and I always tell him. Could you tell everyone about your breakdancing career?
Oh, that's
I'd
so
go
awesome.
For breakdancing.
Right on. Fourth question. What would you rather, form a boy band with your sons or form a country band with your wife?
Oh, that's a good one, Johny. That's a good one.
I would love to form a country band with my wife, because I, for one, if you know me, I always wear cowboy hats because of where I grew up. In the school I went to up country on Maui, it's all Paniolos. And all my friends used to call me the surfing cowboy when I was younger. And I love country music. I mean, that's the bottom line.
Who's your favorite, by the way?
Just my wife sings really well. Her whole family's very well music-oriented, and I always ask her to just sing country music. But famous country singer Willie Nelson.
Dang, that was
Come
it.
Come on, the GOAT.
Yeah, that was it. Willie turned you on wasn't Johnny Cash.
I like old. I mean, yeah. I like old school.
Willie.
But then I also like Florida Georgia Lines. I'll listen to like new age pop country on the radio. Like I like it all.
It's incredible. Right on. Eminem and
country.
Yeah.
Our last question: what would you rather, compete in the Peahi challenge without a life vest or without shorts?
I'll compete without a life vest. The life vest doesn't, I mean, it's a ticket home, but, you know, I think most people rely on those things.
It could have been funny, though, you know, just having the life vest and no shorts, no panties.
Yeah, that would be pretty funny, yeah.
No panties.
And last but not least, a thing that we do over here is by the end, we give our guests the Aloha Hour Award. Here, this is for you.
Look at this award. Wow.
The Hama!
And you get the Hama Award.
The Hama Award.
The Aloha Hour Hama Award.
Thank you, guys. For all you guys talking or watching, listening, I'm leaving with two amazing awards.
Yeah, this is the
best one.
These
are going to go on the top of the trophy. Well, I got the Aloha Hour with Johny and Dewey. First place, Lion Kemper, Barrel of the Century, and yeah. I got the Aloha Hour Hama Award. These are monumental, you guys. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Truly, truly such a, you know, honor to be on this. And I think, you know, it's like the recognition that our islands get is not what we deserve. And like you said, Aloha is it's taken for weakness, man. And it's not. Aloha is the most... It's
powerful.
It's so powerful, and it's monumental. It's something that I carry with me everywhere I go, and I just I love the hour I was here, and I'll be sure to continue carrying all this this vibe with me.
I don't know what to say, Billy. I mean, you made my day as a 56-year-old man listen to
100%.
you, and super inspiring. I learned
super
so much from you today.
Man.
Yeah, and I think you're gonna be in, slam that thing.
Yeah, that's it, boys.
Listen, come back anytime.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Right. Take it easy.